You guys did a wonderful job. You guys are amazing. Can you give them a hand? Aren't they amazing? Praise the Lord. Daniel, great job. Great job. Wow. Debbie, you can't ever miss Sunday morning again. No, ever again, Debbie. Ever again. You're mandated here every Sunday with a blueberry cake donut. Man, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, I was I want to share something before the choir goes down. How many of you have a need in your life? Maybe a financial need, or maybe some of you need clothes, or maybe some of you maybe you need some lumber to build something. I don't know. How many of you have a need? Here's what I'm going to encourage you to do. I'm going to encourage you that whatever you have a need in, I encourage you to sow a seed in it. I'm going to encourage you to sow a seed in it. And if you have a need, sow a seed. That's the way that I've always been taught. And you know, if it's financial, well, I don't have anything. Oh, yeah, you have a seed. You have a seed. Have a seed. You just need to sow whatever it's in. You just need to do it. And I'm not saying that's what we're going to do now. I'm not going to stop you. If you're feeling led to do something for somebody, that's fine. But just sow a seed. And this is, there's something that was resonating in my spirit this evening. You know, perhaps maybe I knew better than anyone how blessed we are in the music department, or really every department at Maranatha. But this music department, by God's grace, makes it very easy to get up here and preach a message. It really, if you've ever been into a church, and you get up there sometimes and it's difficult, a lot of times it's because the worship just was stifled, and you all allow an atmosphere of worship to take place that it makes a very easy transition and very smooth, and I'm very thankful for that. But I'm very grateful for two worship leaders that's just incredible. They're just amazing. And I was talking to a man of God the other day, and he called me, and I tried to call him, and then he tried to call me, and I tried to call him back, and we finally connected, and come to find out he wasn't trying to call me at all. He was trying to call someone else. That's the way it usually goes with me. There was a price saying, oh, no, there he is, you know. It's a joke. He had to be here this morning to get it. Anyhow, I finally got a hold of the man of God, and we were talking, and he said, you know, he said, I had another preacher friend ask me, he said, how is it that everywhere you go, you always have tremendous worship leaders? He said, everywhere you go, it doesn't matter what hall you pastor, what hall you're up and you pastor, you always have a tremendous worship leader. He said, I'll tell you why I always have a tremendous worship leader. He said, because I sowed the best one I ever had. It was my daughter, and it was Nicole's daddy that told me that. You think about that. In correlation to this, that whatever you have need of, you sow, that's what you're going to reap. And the way that you sow it is the way that you'll reap it. I believe that that man of God always has a phenomenal worship leader everywhere he goes is because he sowed his daughter into ministry years ago. And I'm so thankful that they landed at Maranatha Fellowship. Amen. Can you put your hands together and thank this music department? Come on, stand your feet and honor this music department. They're incredible. They truly are. Come on. They are incredible. I thank God for every one of them. They're amazing. They are amazing. They're amazing. And next Sunday, there better be a blueberry cake donut down there. No, I'm teasing. I won't eat one. I won't eat one. I won't eat one next Sunday. No, I don't need any. I'll give them to your boys. Praise the Lord. Was that Jeremiah or Judah? Judah. You all about that, aren't you, Judah? Jeremiah's asleep. Yeah, if he was asleep, he'd be up here and say, where are they at? I know. Praise God. All right, we're going to go ahead and give them another hand, if you would. Amazing. I'm just going to speak for probably about 75 minutes, and then we'll go ahead and go. Laugh now, cry later is what I say. No, we still need about 50 more people to sign up for Mealmania. Please do that on your way out. If you haven't already signed up, please do that. We need you to sign up. Staff, if you haven't signed up, please go ahead and do that so we can have a running count as to how many we have. I'm going to speak to you this evening from John chapter 6, verses 60 through 68. It's one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible just because of the way that it lays everything out. And I'm going to hit this from a little bit different direction this evening. Well, to be honest with you, I really don't know what direction I'm going to hit it from. Please be praying for Pastor Susan Fazell. She hasn't been feeling well the past couple days. She pressed through this weekend. We had kids camp meeting Thursday and Friday. Had well over 100 in attendance each night. It was phenomenal. There were 5 saved Thursday evening and 2 saved Friday evening. Our kids' ministry department is tremendous. Pastor Brian, may the Lord bless you and Pastor Susan and bring recovery into her body. I called her, I think it was Friday evening. She called me back, and I'll be honest with you, she sounded terrible, and I said, oh, Jesus, help her. And so she was not able to be here this morning or this evening, but please pray for her. In John chapter 6, verses 60 through 68, now understand, I'm picking this chapter up on the very end of the chapter, and this is 71 verses long, so there is a lot that is taking place in John chapter 6. And I encourage you to go back and read all of it. It's an incredible chapter. Jesus, chapter 6 is full of mighty acts of God. You see over 5,000 fed. You see him walk on water. You basically, if you really get into it, you will find that Jesus, and this is what I picked up as I read over this afternoon, that Jesus, his disciples launch out in the boat. He's spending time with the Father up in the mountains, and his disciples launch out into a boat. And if you're not careful, you'll miss this. They launch out into a boat, and it says that when they're on the sea, it said that Jesus came to them and walked on the water. It said that the instant that he stepped in the boat, they arrived at shore. You missed it. He teleported them right to shore. See, you see, many times we miss the miraculous of God because we expect to see it in a different fashion. See, my God has no distance. He has no time. Nothing restricts God. I'll get sidetracked. I got to display discipline. But get in there and find out the mighty acts of God in this chapter. It's incredible. God can get you from point A to point B. It should take you 3 hours. He can get you there in a split second if he wants you there. And I believe we really press into the heart of the Father. I believe that we'll see things we've never seen before. I believe that we'll see things we've only read about. I believe that God will bring back some of those acts we've seen in the Bible that we thought were long gone. They were just there for teaching purposes. I believe we'll relive them all over again if we'll just press into the heart of God. Woo, man, I'm stirred already. Verse 60, therefore many of his disciples, tell your neighbors, many disciples, more than just the 12. Go ahead, tell them it was more than just the 12. Man, it's in kindergarten. I'm not going to get on to you for talking unless you're talking when I'm talking. As a joke. Hey, Jay, come up and finish this, would you? That's a wrong response, Jay. Therefore, many of his disciples, when they heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can understand it? When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples complained about this, he said to them, does this offend you? What then if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life, and the flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who would betray him. I love that verse. Jesus knew from the beginning who was going to betray him. But he still loved him, and he never treated him any differently. He knew from the beginning. Let me say that again. He knew from the beginning who would betray him and who would go against him, yet he loved them anyhow to the point that they never even felt different. Jesus, help us to love like that. Man. Verse 65, And he said, therefore, I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it is granted to him by my Father. Verse 66. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then Jesus said to the 12, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? God, help us to be... Help us to be sold out to you to the point to where we have nowhere else to go. You have the words of eternal life. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. In verses 66 through 69, let me see if there's anything I want to hit before that. Nope. Verses 66 through 69, from that time many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. At this point, and now listen, you have to understand that some of the disciples that were walking with Jesus, it was more than just the 12. Many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. They stopped walking with him. They left his presence. They were not willing to know him completely. They only wanted the part of Jesus that felt good and looked good. They didn't want the difficult part that came with Jesus. And you're either going to take Jesus the way he is, or you're not going to take him at all. We like to take the Jesus that heals and saves and delivers, but we don't like the one that adjusts us along the way. Everything was fine as long as Jesus was doing miracles and signs and wonders and feeding the 5,000 and giving these disciples food. But the very instant that he begins to talk about being the bread of heaven, the bread of life, and how they need to receive the bread of heaven and they need to eat of the bread of heaven, which means that if you're going to eat the bread of heaven, you're going to have to adjust to the bread of heaven. That's where the problem came in. When he started lining himself up with God the Father, they said, oh, hold on now. You're walking a line that borderlines blasphemy right here. In other words, they were willing to receive the miracles, they were willing to receive the signs and wonders, but they were not willing to receive God as Jesus Christ the Son. Sometimes there's going to be hard sayings in your life. Says in verse 60 that Jesus said hard, they said, this is a hard saying, who can understand it? Jesus will not always give you easy instructions to follow. Sometimes there's hard sayings as you walk out your relationship with God. When he says, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. When it says, be ye holy as I am holy, Jesus said. Touch not any unclean thing. Keep your heart pure. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Sometimes there's hard sayings. What if God said move? What if God said sell it? What if God said no? What if you lost your daddy to cancer? What if you lost your grandbaby in the third trimester of the pregnancy? Those are some hard sayings. But are we willing to know God in that manner? Are we willing to know him in a manner of which maybe there's no other definition, no other recorded time where you can know God in that fashion to where you can refer to and say, this is what he's doing. Sometimes he's asking you to walk where no one else has walked. Because there's a precedence that he wants to set in your life that may help others. Hard sayings. Hard times. Sometimes life is hard. Sometimes dying makes life look easy. Sometimes it'd be easier just to die than it is to live it out, but that's not what God has in mind. He wants to live out on the inside of us in front of a whole lot of other people so they will know Him in that manner. Because you see, the difference is you have a foundation in Jesus Christ, and He's trying to reach the ones that does not. They're trying to walk through these hard saints, and they have no foundation, but you have a foundation. You've walked through it. Now God wants to build on the foundation He's laid in you. But as we walk through these things, we have difficulty seeing beyond ourselves. And we have to understand that when God does something in our life, very rarely does it just affect us. Very rarely is it just for us. God's scale, His scope is so much grander than ours. Do you not understand that you are called to be ambassadors of the kingdom of God? You are to rule and reign in the kingdom of God. Don't get big-headed with that. It's responsibility is what it is. But He wants to live His life out through you so that other people will come to know Him as Savior, as Deliverer, as Healer, as Friend, as soon coming King. Oh, praise the Lord. You all were shouting when I was preparing this downstairs. 67, verse 67. 66, let me hit that again. From that time on, many of His disciples went back and walked with Him no more. They checked out. They checked out of walking with Him. How many people can you count that's checked out? They've checked out because of a hard saying. Because being off drugs was hard. And they checked out and went back. Don't you check out and go back. Don't you dare do that. I challenge you. I triple dog dare you to get close to Jesus. A lot of people check out when it gets hard. They check out as long as it's just easy. Hey, anybody can stay in it when it's easy. But when it gets hard, now we're going to see. Now we're going to see if anything you were jumping up around the altar and praising God for 3 weeks ago, now we're going to see if anything stuck while you were doing that. It says, many of His disciples went back and walked with Him no more. 67. Then I love what Jesus says to the original 12. He said, many of His disciples went back, which was more than a 12, and walked with Him no more. Then He looks at the 12 and said, you all want to leave too? You want to leave? You want to leave Jesus? You want to walk away from Him? It's what Jesus asked His disciples, do you want to leave too? And then Peter, I love his response. And I'm going to paraphrase this. He said, where will we go? I have nothing to go back to. I sold everything to be here. I gave up everything just so I could walk with you, Jesus. I burned up every bridge that I know. That's a true disciple. When you've given up everything that you had, just because you had a word from God, just because you heard Daddy's voice, you let go of everything. As a disciple, to where you're so dependent upon Him, you can't take a breath unless He gives it to you. You don't know which direction to go unless He tells you right or left. You don't know what to preach unless He gives you a word. You don't know how to respond unless God... I got a text this afternoon on my phone. They were calling the office this week, and this one pastor wants me to come and preach a camp meeting for him. And a lot of people would just say, oh, yeah, I'll do that. And I got a text, Pastor Darren, do you know whether you can come preach a camp meeting for me or not? And I have to be honest and respond, I don't know yet. My dad hasn't told me if I can come or not. Because you see, if I'm not the one that God wants, I'm just going to be a bag of hot air in that sanctuary. But if I'm God's man for that appointed moment, then souls will be saved and the kingdom of God will be in operation. It is not just enough to build up a name for a man. We must have the perfect will of God in operation. It's very easy to get caught up in it and be seen and be heard. But being seen and heard will not advance the kingdom of God unless Jesus Christ is seen and He is heard. There's been too many men and women of God that has been seen and been heard, and it has not advanced the kingdom. It may have filled purses and pocketbooks and wallets. It isn't about how nice of a car we can drive and how big of a home we can live in. It's about the kingdom of God being in operation. Yes,
hallelujah.
Yes. I got to be honest. I don't want my next breath unless God is in it. I've asked Him that when I stop being your man behind this pulpit, You move me out of the way. You want to go away too? No. I sold everything to get here. I gave up everything to get here. I have nothing to go back to. I hold nothing in reserve. That's a problem because many of us, we're holding things in reserve in case this thing with Jesus doesn't work out. Well, I'll just hold this relationship in reserve over here. I'll just hold this in reserve over here, and if it gets real good with Jesus, I'll let this go. But if there's any rocky water, then I'll just go back to this relationship. You better cut that thing off, because it'll send you straight to hell if you don't get rid of it. And we're holding back from God. I'm going to be honest, you're cheating on God. Many times in the Word of God, it paints Israel as a picture is that they were cheating on God, that they were in an adulterous relationship with God because they were putting others before God, and God will have no part of it. God either has first place or He has no place in our life, and that's just the way that it is. There's no shaded areas. You're either in or you're out. You're either hot or cold. You can't ride the fence and get there. You can't ride the fence and serve Jesus. You can't ride the fence and be sold out for God. You can ride that fence and you're going to get splinters and go to hell. Just like a lot of people are holding back. They're holding things in reserve. Too many are holding back from God. Too many people are laying out of God's house. Hey, take your vacation. Hey, I get it. Take your vacation and get back to God's house. Well, I was there last Sunday night for the fireworks. I don't get this, and I'm not going to apologize for it. I don't get this. It's like when summer hits, people feel like that they're on summer vacation from church. You go ahead and play your little God games all you want to, but don't come crying. Don't come crying to leadership when all hell breaks loose in your life because you've laid out and you just want to go ahead and go float your boat and go shoot this and go do this and go play that and go look at this. Then, my God, then you want to use your family as an excuse as to why you did it. You better be careful what you're using as an excuse. God can take that. Wasn't your family? You left your family at home when you went out and played. Everybody said, who told him? Nobody told me anything. Don't get mad at me if it smacks you between the eyes. That's not even in my notes. Get a copy, yeah. Oh, well, the kids are on summer vacation. We'll just wait and go back to church in the fall. No, you won't. No, you won't. Nope. Well, I'll go back at Christmas. No, you won't. You won't go back till all hell breaks loose in your life again. I better move on. Verse 68 says, Peter said, answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. What would it be like to live a life that did nothing unless you heard God speak it? Peter said, now, to where would we go? He said, you hold the words of eternal life. I don't know which direction to go in unless you tell me, Dad. I don't know what to do unless you tell me. I only know what to do by watching you. What would that be like? I challenge you to live it. He said, you hold the words of eternal life. Verse 69, this is where I want to get to and I'll close. Also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. We've come to believe and know Him. How did the disciples get to know Him, that He was the Christ, the Son of the living God? You know, by God's grace, on July 30th of this year, my wife and I will be married 27 years. Hallelujah. And you see, I know her. She's my best friend. She's my best friend in this whole world. She's my baby doll. Outside of God moving in my life, the thing that I enjoy the most is hearing her laugh. One of my wife's favorite things to do is laugh. She loves to laugh. I hear her laugh the most when she's around our two sons, when they're acting stupid, goofing off. I can hit a softball further. No, you can, I can. They're still competitive, if you couldn't tell that by last Sunday night. And they can make her laugh. And I love to just listen. It brings me joy. Because I know who she is. I know her likes and her dislikes. I know her strengths and her weaknesses. I know her little quirks. And she's got them. Don't tell her I'm telling you that. She got a couple. Not very many, but a couple. But she's my best friend. You see, I didn't get to know her to that degree by accident. I did it on purpose. I pursued her. Remember, I told you about that night at the mall. Remember that? How many of you remember that? Okay, I won't tell it again. It stirs me up every time I think about that and relive that. Just looking across that mall and looking at that eyebrow. Whoa! And I was in pursuit. I didn't get to know her by accident. I did it intentionally. I went after her. I wanted to know her better. I wanted to know her more. It just so happens that she was receptive to that. And when she was receptive, I got to know her a little bit better. And I got to listen to her laugh, and I liked her laugh, and I watched her eat, and I liked the way that it was cute how she would eat things. In those days, she had the big 80s hair. Oh, my Lord, I wish the 80s would come back. Lord, the EPA would shut houses down now. She could use the hairspray. What was it? They tease that? Is that what it was? They tease that stuff? You get to stand up, then you had to spray it down with hair. Spray. Whew. Like a cloud. The man had looked good. The peg jeans. Okay, nobody knows what that is anymore. Where am I at? Oh, I pursued her. You see, wow. See, I was first attracted to her by the way that she looked. But then as I got to know her, I fell in love with her. My God. Because I realized that she was deeper than just that outward beauty. Oh, she was much deeper than that. She's the greatest human being that I know, truly. I mean that. But I didn't get to know her by accident. I did it intentionally. That's the way it is with God. You won't get to know Him by accident. You have to do it on purpose. It has to be intentional. He wants it to be intentional. And the Word of God says, He says, draw near unto me, and I'll draw near unto you. In other words, all He wants to know is, do you want to be my friend? Do you want to be near me? He said, if you want to be near me, I'll scoot up close to you. And the amazing thing is the closer you get to Him, the closer He'll get to you. But it'll never be by accident. It'll be intentional. You'll have to pursue Him because He wants to know, do you want me near? He's always there. He's always ready to be your friend and to love you and save you and provide for you and heal you and deliver you and be the way and be your friend. But it will not be by accident. It'll be on purpose. And I want to encourage you in these last few minutes, if I could. JD and Nicole, you can come. I want to encourage you to pursue your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Pursue your personal relationship with Jesus so that you know Him as Savior, you know Him as healer, as provider, as deliverer, as friend. Many people in this room just know Him based on someone else's relationship with Him. But that's not what He's after. He's after you. And you see, the way that we do that is very simple, really. You see, the way that I got to know my wife was through conversation, talking to her, communicating with her. And that's the way we get to know Jesus, is through prayer, communicate with Jesus. Prayer is simply this, it's talking to the Father. It's talking to Him. He loves the sound of your voice. He loves it when you spend time with Him. That's one of the ways that you pursue a personal relationship is that you talk to Him, you pray to Him, you get in the Word and find out. You see, I believe that this Word is His heart. And I believe that we get to know His heart by reading the Word of God. I believe one of the ways we pursue our relationship with God is through praise and worship. I believe it's by getting into His presence and letting Him do what He desires to do. You see, every one of us need to get to a point in a place where we can hear Him for ourselves. I know that you've heard me say this a lot lately. I can't stress it enough. You must pursue Jesus Christ to where you can hear what He's saying for yourself. So that you know which direction He wants you to go in. So that you don't have to make a phone call and ask someone else. He'll witness to you in your heart about what you're supposed to do if you'll just go after Him. I'm not saying you can't ask someone, that you can't get a witness from someone. I'm not saying that. But what if you can't get a hold of someone for a witness? What are you going to do? We must learn to hear God for ourselves. We must learn to hear Him speak to us. Pursue that personal relationship. This is where I want to close. Many just want their food already chewed up for them. Just give me a word. Just give me a word. Just give me a word. Just give me something already chewed up. You've already done the legwork. You've already spent the time in prayer. You've already received it. You just give it to me now. That's what many of us in God's house want today, is we just want a word. You don't want to do the legwork. You don't want to spend the time in prayer. You don't want to spend the time. You don't want to get in God's Word. You don't want to just rest in Him. You just want to get a word from someone else, and then you want to take off and you want to run until you need a word from somebody else. And then when you can't get at this house, you'll run to another house. And when you can't get it from there, you'll run to another house. And you just jump from house to house to get a word after word after word. You just want something already chewed up. You're just like a baby bird with your mouth always open, and the mother comes and pukes in. It's really what it comes down to. And you see, when you pursue a personal relationship with God, it means you're willing to spend that time in the presence of God. That you're willing to pray unto God. Say, God, what is your heart in this matter? God, I'm not going to move. I'm not going to give an answer about camp meeting until I hear your heart in it, Daddy. I'm not going to say yes until I hear your voice, Dad. I'm not going to move until I know which direction you're leading me in. This is the reason why it's so vital. The reason why it is so vital for you to hear God for yourself is because one day the day will be dark. And there will be no one else around you to comfort you and to pat you on the back and say you did the right thing. And the only thing you will have is that moment in your life where you know that you pursued God and you went after God. And you were in that still, quiet place with God, and He spoke to you. And you received that word. In that dark day, you can go back to that time and that place where you received that word and say, no, not even hell can shake me, because I know that I heard my Father's voice. That's why it's so critical. And I'm sure I've shared this before, but I just feel impressed to share it again. See, since I've been the senior pastor, there's been some dark days in my life. There's been some unexpected happenings. There's been some hard sayings, if you will. Some things that happened that I sure didn't see coming. And in those hard times, in those hard sayings, it'd be very easy to say, oh God, did I miss it? Isn't it amazing that when we begin to go through a hard time, we think we've done something wrong? And when you're doing your best to pursue after God and follow the heart of God, why is it that we always cry? Well, I must have done something. There must be sin in my life. Maybe I missed that turn back there. No, maybe the reason why you took the path you did, maybe that's what brought this on. Maybe you didn't miss anything. There's been some hard days. Very easy to go back and say, oh God, man, what, God, are you sure? You really? You sure I'm the one, God? And this is the thing that I referred back to. I remember in that day that I was asked to come, there was all kind of voices around me screaming at me, spiritual and literal. Don't do it. Don't go. Go ahead. Go ahead. No, stay. Go. And I was a mess. Until one day I got away from everybody and I shut the door. I said, Father, I'm not moving anywhere until I know that I've heard your voice. And this is where I've always gone back to. This is what he spoke to me. He said, do you want peace or do you want comfort? He said, here you have all the comfort you can stand. You have a nice home. Church is growing. You make a nice salary. You have all the comfort you can stand. He said, but you're miserable. You have no peace. He said, if you go to St. Albans, I'll give you my peace. But I warn you, you will not have comfort. I chose God's peace. And I left comfort. This is my word to you. Stop listening to all the outside voices. Shut the door. Get in God's presence and say, Lord, what is your direction from my life. And don't move until you've heard him. And once you've heard him, it doesn't matter what comes your way. I know that I've heard from the Father. That's what a personal relationship. Listen, Becky Limley is not your source. Nicole Stewart is not your source. Evan Vance, as good as he is not your source. I'm not your source. No one takes God's place. He is always first and foremost. Stand your feet, if you will. Stand your feet. And what God gives you will get you through dark days and dark seasons in your life if you'll just pursue your personal relationship with the Lord. So if you desire a greater personal relationship with the Lord, I invite you to come. I invite you to come right now. If you need to accept him as your Lord and Savior, come now. He died on the cross for you. He loves you. Hear me, God is not angry with you. He's not angry with you. He loves you. Don't you believe that lie that he's angry with you. He's not angry with you. He loves you. He's trying to draw you close to him. So just come. Just come. Pursue that personal relationship with the Lord. Some of you need to hear from God. The only way you'll hear is to press into his presence. You don't need to make 5 phone calls. You just need to get on your face before God and cry out to him and listen for him. Whatever your need is, you come. As they sing, you come this evening. Sing this along with her if you would. Let's just press into his presence for a little bit. Yes, Lord. Help us not to be satisfied with where we are.
Your presence, open my eyes. we're so thankful that we can actually be in the very presence of a living God, the uncreated one, the one who always was, the one who always has been. We're so thankful that you made a way for us, God, to hear your voice, to know your ways, God. You've made it available to us, God. Don't let us let that slip away. God, I pray that you would burn in our hearts the desires of your hearts. God, that we would have the desire of your hearts burned in our hearts, God. Oh, Father, that you would make the imprint of your heart upon our hearts, God. Oh, that we would pursue your ways, that we would pursue, Lord, your things, the things of God. Oh, God, that we would be able to walk away from the things of this world and the way the world says things are to be, that we would turn a deaf ear. Oh, and Lord, that we would only hear your voice. And Father, we're so thankful. We're so thankful for what you've done tonight. We're so thankful for your presence and for the reality. Oh, for the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Can you go ahead and just give the Lord a praise offering this evening? That's wonderful. Please stay around the altar as long as you want. Please make sure you sign up for Millmania. We still need about 50 more people. One other thing, if you wear a size 44, jacket, 36 pants, I've got some suits that I love to give you. If that's you, but I don't have enough for everybody, and I might even be able to put some shirts in there. But if that's your size, please come up to me after service, and we'll see if we can't. Only if you're going to wear them. If you're not going to wear them, I expect to see them. A lot of people don't like to wear suits anymore. It's a lost art. It's a joke. Well, Father, we just thank you, Father, for who you are. Thank you for your loving kindness, Lord. We thank you, Father. Lord, I pray you just deal with our hearts, Father. And Lord, that if we have a need, Lord, help us to learn how to sow. Help us to sow, Father. It's the way of the kingdom. So, Father, I pray that you just give us wisdom and direction. I thank you for it, Lord, and I ask it in Jesus' name. And amen. We'll see you Wednesday evening. Thank you for coming out. May the Lord bless you tonight.